So I worked with Alexis in the past with the when I was with the behavior response team. So when I had the opportunity to present with her, I basically said, we're tag teaming on the presentation together. You have no option. We're just going to do it. So together we're going to talk about the high and low tech aids to support living safely in the home. And a large part of this presentation will talk about wandering as a risk or someone trying to get out of their home or wherever it is that they're located. So just to give you that heads up. I also wanted to just give, to begin with, some considerations to keep in mind as we talk this evening around this topic. And I think the first thing that really struck me with this topic is comfort really varies from person to person with the use of technology. And that really came to me because of Susan, Alexis, and I actually were in Toronto in December at a Finding Your Way Home conference. It was a symposium. And that symposium, they actually released the website that talks about technology aids on the Finding Your Way website. And in the audience, there were caregivers, there were people living with dementia, and there were professionals from a variety of organizations. And what was really interesting for me was seeing some caregivers talking about the amount of technology that they use, from extremely high tech to actually not quite as intrusive. And so I think it's really important to keep that in mind, that what one caregiver finds as comfortable for them to use may not necessarily be what another caregiver finds as comfortable to use. So we're going to talk about that in this presentation. I really appreciated what was said earlier around the discussion on safety and timing, because really it is important to have that discussion with your loved one who has dementia sooner rather than later. If you are that person's power of attorney, when you become the acting power of attorney for care, you are acting as that person's voice. You're making the decisions that they would make. So it's important for you to know what they would want with respect to technology and with respect to keeping them safe. Alexis, as an occupational therapist, is very, very focused on safety and maintaining independence. And in what she's going to describe is the difference between some of the technology being proactive and keeping people safe versus sometimes being a little bit more reactive. As well, I hate to tell you, there's no single solution. And people change as they journey through their disease process. And I think all caregivers in the room know that every day is a new day, it's a different day, and you're having to adapt. And the same thing for the person who has dementia as well. So there is no single solution, and you have to be creative. And there are so many different things available now that can be used to support. Technology is used to either increase independence or to maintain independence fundamentally and to increase safety. It's also used to reduce emergency response time. And this is kind of a bit of a disclaimer with the information that we're going to provide to you tonight, in that if someone does leave their house, if someone has wandered, if they have gotten lost, please call 911. Call 911 right away. So at least the police can get started, because from presentations we've been to the symposium that we were at in Toronto, we heard stories where, things turned out well in the end, and then we also heard stories where they didn't. And part of it was that police didn't get called fast enough. So with that nice light comment, this is a really, at the end of this, of what Alexis will be providing, and I'll probably chip in a little bit while she talks, but we're going to talk about the ethical considerations, because that's the thing that I find really fascinating. So I'm anticipating that we're going to have a really good dialogue at the end of this. So I will pass this along to my esteemed colleague.
And I just want to say I'm so impressed with how many people came out today. We really appreciate that all of you came here today. So as Karen was saying, we're going to focus the first part of this on some proactive strategies for wandering, because we really don't want to wait until the person has already gone missing, really. Because once they've gone missing, we really have a short period of time to try to locate them. So we really want to try to focus on how we can identify wandering risks and try to prevent that as soon as we can, really. So I've put up here a list of some different proactive strategies to consider. So the first one is just thinking about the environment. And it may seem simple, but just something like removing coats and umbrellas and shoes from the door. Sometimes when people see those things, it kind of automatically triggers them to think, okay, well, it's time for me to get going. I better put on my coat and I've got to go to work. I must have a place that I've got to go. And also, if you see people, I know I was told this when I visited the day program, actually, at McCormick Home, but they were reminding us maybe to take off our coats, because sometimes when you see people in coats, it kind of cues people that they want to go out the door. So just simple things like looking at your doorway. Looking for signs that somebody might be ready to leave. When we were at the Finding Your Way conference, we heard from a gentleman who was talking about his father, and he said that he always knew that his father was ready to leave, and it was usually in the late afternoon, which we usually call the sundowning period, and his father would always start to comb his hair, like he was grooming himself, like he had some place to go. So it's just those small little things that are different from everybody, but if you can kind of recognize those things, you might notice when somebody's getting ready to leave. This is a really big one. Considering why somebody might want to leave. It's really important to know that wandering is not just meaningless kind of walking about. There's usually a purpose for why people want to leave the home. There's all sorts of different reasons, and again, they're different for everybody, but one of the main ones that we often see is a need for exercise. Sometimes when we see people in their homes and they're not really active and doing a lot, they can become restless, and they may want to pace and walk about. So it's important that when we talk about wandering too, we're not saying that all wandering is bad. Wandering can really serve a purpose and can be a meaningful activity for many people and can really serve as physical exercise. And we all have that need to be active and engaged. So knowing that often people may wander just because they want to be physically active. So one of the best strategies for wandering has actually been to have regular walks throughout the week. So trying to get your loved one out for a walk maybe during the day may help reduce that need to want to wander at that risky period at night when you're not always able to watch them. Isolation, loneliness, boredom, as I was saying, if somebody's not really stimulated during the day, they might just get up and go, right? So making sure that people are really engaged. And I think the day programs have been one of like a wonderful resource for people to be engaged during the day. And sometimes that can really mentally stimulate them and physically stimulate them so that maybe they sleep a little bit better at night too. As I was saying, in terms of wandering being a really positive thing, making sure that there's just safe and clear pathways, even in your house. And then at night, there's lights so that they can see where they're walking. And maybe if you have a backyard, you can have a secure area in the backyard where they can safely walk. And I was mentioning the sundowning period. One of the caregivers that we heard talk at the Finding Your Way conference that was talking about his father who would like to comb his hair, he said that he used to always have him eat lunch and exercise kind of right before that sundowning period at night. So again, he was more tired and not really wanting to be as physically active at night. Okay. So I'm really glad that Jim and Lorraine already pointed out one of the most well-known kind of identification aids that we promote, and that's the Safely Home Wandering Registry. So this is a great aid, and this is mainly for if somebody has already gone out of the home and they've become lost. It's a great way to help identify them. So I'm not sure, many of you maybe have already heard about the Safely Home Wandering bracelet, but basically it's an identification bracelet. You can see the pictures up there on the screen. So there's a necklace and a bracelet, and the bottom one here shows what's on the back of the bracelet. And as you can see, there's a hotline phone number on the top, and there's also a description of pertinent medical information about the person. So it might say Jane. Jane has a memory impairment, and it may say allergies. And basically, when this person is located by the police, they can call that hotline phone number. And that phone number, on the other end, that person will have information about where the person lives, important medical information. And so immediately then the family will be called, and they will be informed of the location of the person and what's happening in the situation. These medical bracelets are also great for if somebody has gone missing and you want to call the police right away, you can inform the police that this person has a wandering bracelet, and then the police can phone this hotline and they can get all the information about where are maybe some typical places that this person goes and their medical information, any information that they need to know about that person. And if anybody is interested too, I do have the prices and costs of some of these topics that I'm going to be talking about today. Now, Karen actually told me about this one in the far right corner. So they're called shoe tags, and they were first developed for runners if they got lost or if they had a medical injury. And it's basically the same kind of thing as the medical alert bracelet, but you can just wear it all the time on your shoes. And then if somebody finds the person, they're able to find out the address and phone number of the person. And I should say that the medical bracelets, they do have a cost for you to buy them, and now they do have a monthly cost for you to maintain that hotline prescription.
Can I just add
something? Yeah, of course.
So with that shoe tag, I apologize, I can't recall the name of the company offhand, but it is a company that
I think it's Road ID, actually.
And so the nice thing, they have bracelets, and they are sporty because they're actually designed for people who are out running, people biking, you name it. And what we find is that sometimes our caregivers also get their own bracelets so that they have them. Mm-hmm. And one of the concerns that I've heard and we've heard from people with respect to the Medic Alert bracelets is that they don't want to be wearing a Medic Alert bracelet, but it's less intrusive. It's a little cooler sometimes when you have, like, you look like a runner and you've got the bracelet on. So lots of different styles, and then the shoe tags are really unobtrusive. So just a consideration. And we're not advertising companies,
no.
But but that's just one off the top of our heads here.
Yeah, that's an important piece. We're just wanting to let you know of all the products that are available. Yeah.
While you're on the topic,
yeah.
I have seen advertisements for a medical alert bracelet with a chip embedded in it.
Yes.
Have you had any experience?
With the chip embedded on it. Now, are you talking about like maybe the fall bracelets? Like, is it? Yeah. What's that? Radio frequency. So the GPS radio frequency, maybe. We're going to be talking about that in a little bit. But you might be also talking about the fall kind of fall bracelets. I'm sure there's somebody in the room with a Connect Care bracelet where you press the button if you've had a fall, and it can go to a call center, and the call center can alert your family that you've had a fall, or they can call 911. So that might be something. But we're going to talk about other bracelets for locating people if they've gone missing. Yeah. Yes.
Long-term home care.
Yeah.
They have some kind of tracking device also.
Really?
On the patient, so because they don't lock their doors.
Right.
And the police can automatically find them right
now. Oh,
wow. And I went, wow, I haven't heard nothing like that in the city.
Yeah.
In the country.
That's neat.
Wow.
That's neat. So thanks very much for sharing that, too. This is what we want to hear, too. We know that you guys probably have tons of your own great strategies that you can probably share with each other. So hopefully we'll have a time at the end of the presentation to do that more, too. So I just want to touch on two more things, too. One thing that we really promote, and I know that the Alzheimer's Society promotes a lot too, is just identification cards. So these can be for the person with dementia to carry with them, and it's very similar to the bracelets, but they can maybe keep it in their wallet, or if a female has a purse, or keep it in their back pocket. And basically, it just has all the same identification kind of information. Here's a picture of one in the corner, if you can see that, but it just says their name, emergency contact information, and their diagnosis. Another thing that we really recommend is for caregivers always to have an identification form in their possession. And sometimes we recommend that you even put that in your fridge or your freezer to make sure, in a plastic baggie, so you make sure that you always have that if somebody does go missing. But in addition to the medical information and the diagnosis and contact information, you can even put on some of those identification forms, things like where are the common places that this person might go? Do they always go to the bank or to a local Tim Hortons? And also putting their appearance, so what they look like. And we've put that it's great to have an up-to-date photo of the person, that if you need to show volunteers that are looking for them or police, you want to make sure that you have an up-to-date photo, and a piece of unwashed clothing just in case they do have to have search dogs involved. Okay, so this is another one of those kind of proactive aids to talk about, camouflage and deterrence. So there's little simple things. We're trying to put some ideas up here for you too that don't cost a lot, but they're simple to do. So things just like hanging curtains or towels over a doorway. Sometimes if people don't know that it's a doorway, they're not necessarily going to be trying to get out of it. So we can kind of disguise it and be quite creative. And painting doorknobs the same color. I have a picture too down there of a door mural. I don't know if anybody's seen that before. I'm pretty sure that you guys have door murals at the day program. So we can actually disguise doors so that they look like a bookshelf, or you can have plants and all sorts of different things so that they might not even notice that the door is there and just keep on walking. We've also had ideas to put, sometimes you can play on, with dementia, sometimes you have visual spatial issues where you might see people, as we see the markings on the floor here, they might think that those black lines there are actually a hole, and you might see them stepping over it. So sometimes we can use that to our advantage by putting a black mat in front of a door where they might think to not cross that barrier because it might be dangerous. So some of these things, obviously, they don't work. Not everybody with dementia has the same symptoms. So what works for one person might not work for everybody.
And not everybody is going to. This is the other thing. Not everybody who has dementia will wander or try to get out. So that's one thing I wish I'd said this sooner, but this is just in the event if this is a behavior that becomes a concern. So I just wanted to.
I think that the statistic that we have on the Alzheimer's Society website is about 60% of people will wander or go missing. So that's about 3 in 5 people. So yeah. So another one that you can see in the corner is just these wander guards. And they're usually at eye level. So you don't want to have it too high or too low. But generally, even into the more advanced stages of dementia, your reading still remains quite intact. And we know these universal symbols for stop and do not enter. So sometimes we can use those to our advantage too. And if they see those, they're not going to want to cross. And then I have in the top corner too, safety handles. So it makes it a little bit harder to open a doorknob. And I don't know if anybody's used those before. I have a little toddler and I use those, and sometimes those are even difficult for me to open the door. So some of these things are very cost effective. And you don't have to spend a lot of money on them.
Those work for me. I can't open doors.
I know, that's what I mean. They're difficult. Okay, so we'll move on to
the next one.
Yeah. So Lorraine and Jim were talking about locating devices. So global positioning systems, GPS. So as Karen was just saying, not everybody with dementia is going to wander, but about 3 in 5 people do wander at some point and go missing. So about 60% And after 24 hours of that person being missing, the chances of finding them significantly decrease. So it's really important that we do take preventative measures. About half of those people that do go missing, unfortunately, they do end up being injured, or very sadly, death may occur. So some of these devices are becoming very popular because they help us locate people when they do go missing. Because otherwise, when people go missing, there's very little way to find them and to locate them. And the Safely Home wandering bracelets are great if you do notice that somebody has dementia and they're missing and you're able to look at the ID. But if you don't know that somebody's missing and they don't help you locate somebody, in other words. So GPS systems, I don't know if any of you have GPS in your cars. It's very similar. It works with satellite technology. And basically, the person with dementia will wear a transmitter. And these transmitters, as you can see on the slide, they come in all different shapes and sizes. So we have watches, pendants, keychains. They even make GPS shoes now and soles that go in footwear. Jim talked about cell phones. And you can even carry some of these devices just in your pocket, purse, or clip to your belt. So how they work is they send a frequency signal, which is picked up by the satellite. And that signal is then sent usually to either a cell phone or a temp... I'm drawing a blank. Tablets, I was going to say template, tablet, my baby brain. Or it could be sent to a call center. And that's going to give you a location about where that person is. And it works within a very large vicinity and can actually narrow the location down to just a few meters. So there are some drawbacks to using this technology. One is the cost. I was looking through different price costs for some of these devices, and they range from about $200 to $400. And then there's usually a monthly cost of about $50 to keep up the devices. But as we were at the Finding Your Way conference, a few of the gentlemen were reminding us the cost of if somebody goes lost is about $5,000 to $10,000 for the government. So really the cost of some of these devices is not as much as you might think. But unfortunately, they're not covered by our government. They do require batteries, most of them, and you do have to charge them. And they usually last for about 48 hours. With many GPS devices, they don't work underwater, and they don't work in thick bush or through walls. So there is some drawbacks to the location that you have to consider when you have these devices. One system also that we heard about at the conference is called Project Lifesaver, and that works through radio frequency, and that's a wristwatch. It weighs about an ounce, and people say that it's quite cumbersome, so that's one of the criticisms to some of these devices, is that the person really has to want to wear them, and it can't be too cumbersome that it's uncomfortable for them. So it really depends on what the person would prefer to whether they'd want to watch, or whether if a lanyard around their neck, are they going to want to keep that around their neck or just take it off? So with the Project Lifesaver, though, it works on a radio frequency, and basically the transmitter is held by the police, and as they get closer to the person, it starts beeping. So it's kind of like a money detector that kind of makes a sound when you get closer to the person. So this works well if you have the GPS to kind of give you the general vicinity. So if you're within a few meters or so of a person, it can kind of help you get closer to that person. Okay. So I'll move on from there, but if you guys have any more questions about the GPS, I'd be happy to answer that at the end. So let's move on to, alarms and sensors. So I remember Lorraine was saying earlier in the presentation that she had a friend who was always noticing that by the time her husband he was already dressed and ready to go by the time she noticed that he was gone. So some of these devices are great for the home because they can alert us, alert a caregiver that somebody is getting out of bed. So we have some very simple strategies that can be implemented, bells or keys on doors. At the conference, one of the community workers was saying that she often tells her clients to put a cowbell on the door, because then that bell will ring loud when the person's opening the door. Also, wind chimes on the door. Now, if we want to know that the person's getting out of bed even before they get to the door, which would probably be the best idea, we can use motion sensors. And so these sensors, as you can see in the picture with the gentleman at the bottom, it's going to make a sound. Pardon me, I'm going to sneeze. It's going to make a sound when this gentleman is getting out of bed, because there's a sensor beam that's going to catch his movement as he gets out of bed. So you can use these sensors on a bed, or you could use them at a threshold like a door in the middle of your house. Some of these motion sensors too make a chime, or they'll make a sound to notify you that they're getting out of bed. And some of them, as you can see on the top slide, they work as a pressure sensor. So when the person shifts their weight and gets out of bed, the pressure mat senses that the weight has changed, and that's when it's going to send off an auditory alarm and let you know that they're getting out of bed.
One of the things that I've heard as feedback with the bed alarm is that sometimes they get triggered fairly frequently when the person shifts around in bed. So sometimes it's not...
Yes.
Not the best, but it is an option that's certainly available.
Yeah. And one thing, depending on the device, you can change the sensitivity so that it's not so sensitive that every time you shift your weight, it chimes, but that it would go off when they actually get out of bed. So that's a good point, Karen. But I think we can move on to the next one.
One thing I would just like to say, with mm-hmm. the door alarms that chime when the door is opened, those are pretty easy to find as well. If you're looking for something that's economical and fairly easy, I think Canadian Tire, I think even Dollar Store. So those are available and very, very easy to install.
Yeah, and sorry, I didn't talk about the one there in the corner that she was pointing to, but basically that's an alarm that there's a little sensor there on the bottom, and as soon as that door opens, it breaks that sensor, and that's going to send out an auditory alarm to the caregiver. And Karen brings up a good point. You can find a lot of these devices just at home hardware kind of stores. Even Bed Bath & Beyond was advertising some of these. But you can also find them at all of your local medical supply stores. So you've probably all heard about Shoppers Home Healthcare or DuraMed. A lot of those stores that prescribe canes and walkers and different equipment, they also have catalogs where you can order some of these things. Okay, and this is just something that I actually recently found out about myself. But it's a home monitoring system, and I've kind of put two examples up there, although we're not promoting these two companies, but they're two local companies that are well known. But basically, these home monitoring systems are companies that will come into your home, and depending on your needs, they will set up different motion sensors and different webcams in the house. And they'll put little alarms on your back door, on your windows, depending on where you think somebody might leave the home. They'll set everything up for you. And it allows you to even monitor a home when the caregiver's not living in the home. So if somebody's living independently and you'd like to keep them in the home for as long as possible, some of these devices allow you to monitor them from a remote location. And basically what happens is, if a loved one... and you can set it up for different time periods if you just want it to be monitoring at night. If a loved one were to go out a back door, it would send you a video picture of the person going out the back door so that you could even know what they were wearing to be able to give that description to the police. It will also tell you if they've gotten out of bed so that you can monitor. There's pictures here of their bed, so you would know whether or not they're going to get dressed to leave. It could also just tell you if the back door is opened and the person is still safely inside. And it will send you a message either through the video camera pictures, or it will send you a text message
or an email or a call, depending on your needs. The company will work with you. So it's a great way to be able to monitor a loved one, especially, as I said, if you're not in the house and you can't always know exactly what they're doing. Yeah, I think we're good. Okay, so how do you choose a device? This can be really tricky, and as I said, what works for one person isn't going to work for everybody, right? So you really have to consider when you're using all these devices, where it will be used. Is it going to be used indoor, outdoors, or as we were talking about, is it going to be used in a care facility? How much freedom of movement will the device allow? So is this a device that's going to allow them to go outside, or are we talking more about the devices like we talked about, the motion sensors and that are just for inside the house? If necessary, will the person with dementia be able to use the device? And I love how Jim was mentioning cell phones, and cell phones are a great device, especially in the earlier stages. And the thing about the cell phones is that you really have to know how to use them. And you have to always have them with you, too. So again, we have to make sure that the person is able to use the device that we're giving them. As we talked about the affordability, with some of the GPS systems that I was talking about, they can be quite pricey. And so there's the initial cost, batteries, but there's also the monthly fees for many of these devices. So the reliability, so has the device been tested? So the nice thing about the Finding Your Way website is that they've actually gone through Google and they've looked up many of these GPS devices, and they've actually reviewed them. A company reviewed them to see which ones were reliable. So that really helps if you can go to that website to figure out what devices are reliable and best to choose. And we talked about, is it comfortable, discreet, and acceptable to the person? Because it's really important that it's something that they're actually going to want to keep on, because it's only effective as long as the person's wearing it, right? So that's why I do like some of those ideas like the shoe tags, when it's less discreet. And when we're talking about Project Lifesaver, which is a big bracelet, I can see why somebody might want to take that off. So it's things you need to really know about your loved one and to consider. Okay, Karen. All right, so we've kind of talked about all the things that are really popular right now, but we wanted to talk about the things that are a little bit controversial, and we're going to talk about the ethics of some of these things, as you can imagine. But technology is just rapidly changing, and some of these things have been coming up more and more in the media in regards to dementia. And one of them, in the middle there, is microchipping. I don't know how many of you heard about this in the media. It was talked about a lot in 2010. A few heads are shaking. But there was a company called Positive ID, and they were actually putting microchips into about 200 people in Florida. So between their shoulder and their wrist, a little microchip. And so this isn't a GPS locating device, as you might think, but it was really a little tag that if a person was lost, you could scan this and it would give you a 16-digit number that kind of similar to the Safely Home Wandering Registry. You'd then be able to call this number and find out where the person lived and all this information. So you can imagine that they're not doing that technology anymore. They shut down the company, and they were actually, some of the controversy around it was that it may be causing cancer, actually. And there was a lot of talk about it, would it be mandatory by the government? So a lot of ethical things, which I think we're going to get into more. So, and as you can see, this is a picture of somebody with a little barcode right on their fingernail. So they were trying to give these scanners away free to hospitals so that you could scan somebody if you found them. And at the top there, I don't know how many people have heard a lot about robots in the media too. So robots are really being used a lot for safety in the home. We're going to show you a clip in a little bit from Toronto Rehab, which talks about Ed the Helper robot and how it can be used in the home and how to help with wandering as well. Pet therapy. Karen was reminding me that at the Finding Your Way conference, there was a gentleman too that had had a cat. So when he saw the cat was kind of a cue for him to sit down and he would socialize and pet with his cat. So again, going back to having socialization and meaningful kind of activities in your day can help with wandering as well. Before we go to the clip too, I wanted to talk about, I'm just gonna draw a blank on the name here. We're seeing too more and more use of social media too in wandering. So in BC, there was a gentleman that actually went missing, and sadly he did pass away. They weren't able to locate him in time. He was missing for 5 days. As a result of that, his son actually started Silver Alert in BC, and it's similar to the Amber Alert system. So when somebody goes missing, there was a lot of media attention on the news, and word traveled over Facebook, and when somebody would go missing, their picture would be on Facebook, and it was also a great way to rally volunteers, because people really want to help, but often they don't have the direction of where to search and where to go and details about the person. So this started, this wonderful project in BC. Fortunately, we don't have it in Ontario, and so there was a lot of talk at the Finding Your Way conference that we really need to have a national agenda to help promote some of these social media kind of ways of helping out with wandering. So things are really changing fast. So what do you think? Do you want to show?
Sure, and I think we'll show the video. It's only, I think it's less than 2 minutes.
Yeah.
But the reason being, with the technology, with Ed, the helper robot, we find sometimes when people get frustrated, they try to do something that they used to do fairly easily, it can lead to distraction. So we find that Ed helps people out to be able to do some of the things that they used to be able to do, reduce some frustration. And also just kind of shows how far technology is progressing, and it will grow in the future.
And we wanted to show Ed too, because this is actually very close to home. This is coming right out of Toronto.
Hi, I'm Nora Young, host of Spark on CBC Radio, and I'm here at the iDapt Home Lab in downtown Toronto, where they're designing technologies that can support people who are older and have cognitive impairments in order to keep them in their homes for longer. And this is the Coach System, which is kind of a little half robot that's going to help me wash my hands, and you know how much I like robots.
Hi, Nora.
Hi.
Let's start washing hands.
Okay, and it's demonstrating what I'm supposed to do with its body language. So
turn on
to do
the water.
Turn on the water. Oh, it's pointing out the faucet.
Great. Wet your hands. Great. Get some soap.
And it really does model the gestures pretty well, if you're uncertain about what to do.
Scrub your hands. Great. Rinse your hands. Great. Turn off the water. Dry your hands.
And lots of positive reinforcement along the way as well.
Good job, Nora. You are all done.
Thanks. And that's all there is to it. It's a cool thing. I'm Nora Young for CBC Radio.
Yeah, that would be nice. Actually, there's one that I saw, too, that was on one of those Rumbas, you know, those little vacuums, so we could have it vacuum your home, too.
Great.
Okay, and we just wanted to highlight, we know we have the tables at the back, which I hope that you'll all take a look at, but here's all the websites that we thought that are really important for you to take a look at. And as Jim and Lorraine were pointing out, the Finding Your Way website is a wonderful website that talks all about the different low and high tech devices, and also has a link to the reliability studies of what devices would be best and the costs of different devices. Great. Yeah. Yeah.
Related question, sort of.
Yeah.
I'm just new to the Alzheimer's group here in London. Mm-hmm. But one of the things I picked up on was the excellent video library of presentations like this tonight. Mm-hmm. So are you, is your presentation going in that library? Will be?
Yep.
That's one of them. Thank
yes. Mm-hmm. Thank you. So I'm going to get all social worky on you here. And we're going to have a discussion around the ethical considerations. And the reason being, I just keep thinking back to that son where he had cameras throughout his dad's home. Mm-hmm. And so he would actually monitor his dad throughout the day. And I wonder if the son, if he worked, maybe he did something IT because he seemed to be at his computer all the time, mm-hmm. but he literally watched his dad the whole time. And so there were times when he'd see his dad start to get up again, like, you know, he'd start to go, you know, get up and start to get his jacket and head towards the door. And so then the son would use a microphone and be like, "Hey, Dad, where are you going? You know, Sammy the cat needs to get fed. Let's get, you know, he needs a cuddle." And so basically, you know, his dad would hear this voice and hear his son and recognize the voice, and then he would actually follow what his son was directing him to do. And for him, so if we look at that broad spectrum of, I guess, sort of the how much how heavy the technology is being used, the son was very much, he promoted technology to the nines. He was so comfortable with it, helped to make sure his dad was safe, and he had absolutely no problems using cameras and audio devices. And then there were other people in the room who just, they didn't feel the same way. They didn't quite feel that, they felt like actually that was a bit of an invasion of privacy. So that's why it's really important, as we mentioned previously, that you have those discussions early on around, you know, if I'm going to stay safe at home, what do I feel comfortable with security? What kind of security would I feel comfortable with? Or maybe the caregiver is uncomfortable using certain things as well. You know, it's too intrusive. So when you're looking at using technology, you know, you have to take into consideration the legalities of technology. Is it legal to use certain devices? Also, you know, these are decisions that should be made also if power of attorney is needed, the person who's power of attorney should be, you know, deciding on certain care decisions. You have to keep in mind the dignity of the individual. Because really technology, we want technology to help maintain dignity, but at what cost? And then also personal values and beliefs. This, you know, how many people in the room thought, that's great that the son has cameras on his dad 24/7? Not, yeah, there are some people, and then there are some that, you know, it just doesn't quite sit well with them.
Yeah. And I think for this family, they had discussions that it was really important to have this father age at home for as long as possible. So it was a fine balance between his privacy and his safety and his ability to remain at home. But for this gentleman, he was able to remain at home for a lot longer because of that, those cameras that were spying on him all the time. So it's...
Monitoring.
Freudian slip.
And, you know, one of the things that, you know, we've heard is that when monitoring devices are being used frequently, it brings the caregiver comfort because they have an idea of what's going on, where the person may be, or if they're going to get alerted. But on the other side of the coin, that may actually reduce the frequency of the caregiver interacting with the person. And so suddenly you lose some of the socialization that would naturally occur when you go to check on someone and help them with a meal or whatever care activity is happening, or just the visit. And I think that's one of the important things, is to, you know, not forget about that social piece. And when we talk about proactive strategies, and you mentioned the day program,
quite often we get referrals to the day program because someone is at risk of getting out and wandering because they're trying to go to work or they're trying to, you know, they're just, they can't remember the way through the neighborhood. And then just when you're busy, when you have a cat, when you have friends to visit, when you have activities to do, that's going to reduce the risk of someone getting out and wandering or getting lost.
To my knowledge, and there may be people in the room that are more knowledgeable about this that can help us, but I believe it is the caregiver's right to be able to put cameras into rooms. Do you mean to monitor their loved ones during personal care and stuff? Yeah.
I think before that action happens, that it's really important that the family have the conversation with the long-term care staff. And because that's a huge trust relationship that you have to have with the long-term care home to take care of someone. And I always, you know, say have those conversations with the manager, with the RN or with the RPNs and say if you have concerns, you need to talk about them. Because I think, you know, we do have people putting nanny cams in the rooms. And when you have concerns, you need to bring them forward. But I hear what you're saying, because sometimes people, they're not going to remember if something happened or didn't happen. But I would hope that people would have trust in the home. I know some pretty amazing homes that I trust. Yeah. So.
And many of these homes do use a lot of the technology that we're talking about, like the motion, the bed alarms, and even the alarms. I'm sure you've heard about the wandering bracelets that they put on residents that will raise an alarm when they go near the door. I've even seen devices where they can send, we know that often a concern is wandering into other residents' rooms, so they can send an alert to the staff that may be carrying a little pager. It does, yeah. And the wandering guards, that's where we really got that idea. They're used quite frequently in long-term care homes.
Yeah. That's a good question. Mm-hmm. So I'm just going to throw this out to you. What do you think are some other ethical considerations with respect to the use of technology? Yes.
My question is not ethical so much. Mm-hmm. I guess I can only relate from my own personal circumstance. Mm-hmm. But I think this whole issue of discussion of these needs and as they become more progressive is necessary for me. I'm a patient. Mm-hmm. But I have to have some idea of what I can anticipate. Is that all right? I have to have some idea of what I can anticipate so that I can discuss it with the people who are going to care for me.
Yeah.
Because I really, for me, it's not a problem to discuss it, but I have to know what I'm going to discuss. Mm-hmm. And so I don't know what's available through counseling. I don't know what's available through workshops like this. Mm-hmm. But I think more and more information about what we can anticipate will allow us to carry out these discussions.
Yeah.
Because I'm still flabbergasted at the number of people my age who don't talk to their family about care homes or wills or all other kinds of things. Mm-hmm. And when you start talking about people with dementia, those kinds of needs have just accelerated tremendously.
Right. Mm-hmm.
We're still living in a time where there's a real stigma of dementia, and it's really challenging for some people to talk about. And I think there's still, you know, as much education as the Alzheimer's Society and organizations like McCormick Dementia Services provide around the symptoms that happen with dementia and the different forms of dementia, you know, we know different stages. So for example, we know different stages that people with Alzheimer's disease will go through. And we know certain symptoms will start to happen in parts of the stages. But then some people don't have some of the behavior symptoms. Like I said, not everybody wanders. And you know, everybody that I've worked with, and I mean, I'm going to say this again, you know, the number of times I've heard reference to the aggressive stage, there is no aggressive stage with Alzheimer's disease. So certainly people can get frightened. They may not understand where they are. They may not remember who the person in the room is with them. They're not able to do certain
care activities anymore. So when they're trying to get assistance, they get frustrated. And then they may, you know, be protective too, because here's somebody I don't even know trying to touch me. Get away from me. That's not aggression. That's them being protective. So your question is really good. What are you going to experience? How are you going to cope? How do you have those conversations with your family, with your friends? Mm-hmm. And, you know, having them permission to talk to you about it too.
Giving organization that has created a document, and I think it's, I was trying to just pull it up on, see if I can pull it up on phone, and it's called
good, like, use of technology, by the way,
7535. So it's, yes, when you're 75 and your children are 30. Is that, am I close?
Yeah.
Is anybody?
Yes.
And it's a document that asks all different kinds of questions, mm-hmm, that everything from finances to home care, what would you want done if you were to, you know, suddenly be in a car accident even,
right, yeah,
and what would you want done with your home, your belongings, yeah, all kinds, yeah, of discussions. So there's pages and pages of questions.
Yeah, I think that was Home Instead. I think Home Instead might have that document.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. How do you from what we've discussed tonight, how do you feel about the use of technology? Does it seem okay to just load up a house full of cameras? Yes.
With the tablets, smartphones, things like that, older people who have not had any experience with those items of technology,
yeah,
it's really, really frustrating, mm-hmm, for them. And it's almost like throwing up my hands while, you know, I haven't used them up to this point, why should I use them now?
Mm-hmm.
But if there was some type of in-service or something, or someone that would say, this is how you use the smartphone, this is how you use the tablet, that would probably help, but it's pretty frustrating, mm-hmm, for those things. And like with Jim, probably, and his wife have had the experience for years, I guess, using those items, and so it probably comes a lot easier to people like them.
Mm-hmm. 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 Definitely.
I just want to support Jim's,
yeah,
point here.
Yeah.
I had a smartphone about 3 or 4 years ago. And I worked and worked and worked. I couldn't never remember what the heck I did last week with the darn thing. I called it a stupid phone and couldn't wait to get rid of the darn thing. So.
Well, I think, you know, and that's a good, you know, it's a good point to mention. You know, how do you learn? How do you, you know, because instructions even aren't that easy to follow sometimes with some of these devices. And then when you, like, I think of my own iPhone, and if I do an update on the operating system and then suddenly it's not working, and then I need the internet, but the internet's on my phone,
yeah,
that's not working. So, you know, so definitely the technology, it's good. It's as good as it is when it works. So that's why sometimes, you know, when we looked at the earlier slides, and we talked about some of those low-tech things, sometimes the high-tech stuff, it doesn't cut the mustard. Sometimes a cowbell is really effective.
I joined Alzheimer's Society, went and offered me an iPod to give to my mother and try to get her to use it,
yeah,
because it's calming, the music.
Yeah.
But it's so small that, mm-hmm, she said, where's the switch to turn it on? And I went, it's right there. Well, I can't see it. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm, you know, it was a waste, but every time I got her in my car, I'd USB it and she'd listen.
Yeah.
So that was a blessing, and I thank them for that.
Yeah.
Excellent.
But to get her to learn how to, right, you know, to use it, big, big task.
Mm-hmm.
I keep trying over and over, but she's just not getting it.
Yeah.
It's kind of like those Rogers or Bell remote controls, all the buttons,
yeah,
on them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Same with TVs, a new TV with the,
yeah,
car.
Yeah.
Oh, in the back.
Sorry, I'm just going to use the mic. Just a second, please. Thank you. My exercise.
My husband uses the iPod at home, and he had the same problem with the buttons. But we have a docking station with a really big button.
Oh, that's a great idea. There you go.
A docking station, which you can put the iPhone on, that would have larger buttons on it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, that's a good idea, putting tape on specific buttons that are going to be used a lot, especially on TV remote controls too, where you can sometimes put something raised, like a little piece of Velcro or a red dot that can kind of just draw attention more to that specific button. You can do that with microwaves too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm just going up here, just a general comment, sort of in our Q&A time.
Yeah.
Yes. So certainly if you also have any questions for Jim and Lorraine, please raise your hand and I will come out with the mic so that everyone can hear the question and the comments and also people online.
We actually have a question for you.
Sure.
Our comment. Did you have a comment?
Yes, I was just thinking about this gentleman's comment about we older people find it much more difficult to learn these things. And I'm wondering if maybe there is room for an establishment with the Alzheimer's Society and all of the other groups in the city mm-hmm. to offer programs where they are actually teaching how to use these instruments
mm-hmm.
rather than us sitting back yeah. trying to learn ourselves.
Yeah.
I fortunately have a techie expert. So this is where I get my information, but all of you don't have that, I'm sure.
Yeah.
So maybe...
Do you want to comment?
I'm going to comment here. I hear your comments, and I guess my idea about this is that I don't expect Jim to use these devices on his own. You know, I'm there to help him. Now he's able to use them to a great extent on his own, but as time goes on, if he becomes more challenged, I would not consider it something I would give him to do when I'm not there.
Mm-hmm.
Because what happens is, when you are using something regularly, the brain seems to be able to hold on to that neural pathway or whatever, you know, it seems to be able to do that. But after a space of time, that goes away. So if you haven't done it for a while, you totally don't know it. You don't even know that you knew it before, you know. So I would not do that. If I could just take a quick moment. When I was living up north, I was volunteering at a Chartwell and a woman with a woman who has, they didn't actually tell me because they couldn't, but I think she was suffering with some form of dementia. And I worked with her as a volunteer, and she really wanted to be able to read. She used to be able to read, and she couldn't read. And I have worked with my own Learning Challenges program with dyslexic people with right brain challenges. I noticed, she said she used to be able to read, no problem. I noticed that she was exhibiting some of the symptoms that right brain people were, you know, that they're not problems, they're actually gifts that they have, but they're more right brain than they are left brain. And so I used some of my strategies for right brain, and it worked, and she began to read. Now, I don't know how long she would remember to use those strategies, but while I was there, she was able to do that. I started bringing in my tablet, and we worked together with the tablet. She really responded to that, but she couldn't do it on her own. Then we graduated to a computer, and her daughter was really surprised that we were sitting at the computer, and she was using the computer with my guidance, you know, to play games or do things, you know, some activities. And she was really responding to that. I would never expect her to do it alone. So, you know, just something to hold on to.
Alexis, did you want to comment on something earlier? Or?
Yeah. No, I just think, the conversations about the iPhones and the tablets are wonderful because they have so many uses. And I definitely agree with everything that you guys have shared. I think most of the wandering devices, I think, that we talked about tonight really do rely more on the caregivers than the person with dementia.
The challenging part can be, as I said, just making sure that the person always has the device with them and has it on them. But most of them don't require them to really have to activate anything, apart from unless you're using a cell phone kind of as a GPS device, and they do have to be able to turn that on and make sure that that's charged and on their person. But the sensory mats and the bells and even all the GPS devices, they're more the caregiver that's really going to have to monitor those.
Yeah, and just a note about some of you asked about the computer classes or learning technology. I'm pretty sure it's here at Third Age Outreach that's located here in the Kiwanis Center that does offer a lot of those programs for older adults who want to learn that technology. So certainly, and I'm sure any of us can connect you with them, but they do offer a lot of programs right here in the building where we are right now. And oh, I see some hands going up. I'm just going to run back. Thank you.
Another option on that might be some kind of variation on the intergenerational choir gym, because nobody can teach me computer stuff like my grandchildren. So that might be something that could be used not only for social contact, but also for learning.
Yes, so I just wanted to add a little story about a client that I had. This was a gentleman who was looking after his wife, who was really quite impaired, but he was very committed to keeping her at home. But he did worry about what happens if something happens to me, which I think is a very common concern among caregivers. And he just came up with this little idea himself that I thought was so clever, so I've often told people about it, and that is that he would keep two lanyards at their front door on a hook. Hers was actually blinged up a little bit with some sparkles, and so it really looked kind of like a nice necklace. And on the end of each lanyard, there was a memory stick. So the memory stick itself was just a memory stick, but when they would go out walking, they would pop these around their necks so that if he collapsed, because he did have heart problems when they were out walking, or if she wandered away from him, the hope was that anybody would notice that they were wearing a memory stick and, you know, realize that maybe we should look at what's on this thing. And then, of course, once they put it in a computer, it would list all the emergency contact information, his health conditions, her health conditions, medications they were on. Of course, you can put lots and lots of information on a memory stick. So I thought that was quite clever and something that he just came up with on his own. The other thing I wanted to mention around the technology piece is the app you can get called Souvienne. Has anybody heard of Souvienne? Souvienne, I believe, is the word for remember in French. And this is an app that can be put on a tablet or a computer, and it's like a photo album on steroids. You can sort of have videos. You can you have pictures of family or things of interest to the person. But if you click on that, if you just touch that person's face, there might be a little audio clip, from the daughter saying, "How are you today, Mom?" and et cetera, et cetera. Or they can play music, or they can do all kinds of things. And it's called Souvienne, and it is a free app that's available. So you might want to look that one up as well.
Nancy, I really appreciate you mentioning about the caregiver also having some kind of information, because that's one of the things that we recommend. Caregivers often kind of forget about themselves in the equation, and one of our biggest fears is what happens to the person who has dementia if something happens to the caregiver. So what you may consider while you have maybe in a wallet some emergency information, about the individual who has dementia, but you can also for yourself have your information and say, "I'm a caregiver, my husband or my wife cannot be left alone." So because there are incidents sometimes when, someone has a stroke or has a heart attack, paramedics show up and the person, the caregiver is taken away and, the person with dementia is left in the house. Hi, Leslie.
Hi. VON has a partnership with the paramedics and it's called Kool-Aid, and you can likely go into any paramedic department. And what it is just a piece of information that you keep on top of your fridge, and there's a sticker you put on your door. And on that information that's kept on top of your fridge is all your medical information, your health card, emergency contacts. If you have a DNR order, that information is there as well, and all your medication. And in a support group this morning, I was handing those out to the caregivers there, and the one lady said, I'll just take one for my husband. And I said, well, you know, you should take one for yourself as well and have information on your health, because if the paramedics had to tend to your home and your husband could not remember where your purse was located or your health card or your daughter's phone number, that information is very important for the paramedics for your health as well. So you can go to any emergency paramedic department and pick up one of those Kool-Aid forms, or contact VON, and we've got them as well.
Does it still come with a sticker that you stick on your... So there's a sticker you put on your door so that when the paramedics arrive, or like the window of the door or whatever, they see that sticker, they know, go right to the fridge.
And we have them too. I've gotten them from the local paramedic folks, so because we hand them out when we're going out to talk about the Finding Your Way initiative. So it's a great combo to have that information.
McCormick Dementia Services has them too.
Excellent. So lots of sources. Yes.
It's a great program.
So you want to make sure that we get that information out there wherever. So you don't have to drive downtown to like Waterloo Street or whatever it is to get them. Yes.
I have two questions. The first one is dementia ever misdiagnosed? Could it be a head injury instead of... Because when the doctor's doing the testing, I don't see no CAT scan, no MRI, no technology done with machines. They come back in the room and they say, oh, your mother has dementia. Okay. The second question is, going back to technology, why is there never any doctors at any of these seminars? Like, that's where it all starts, is right there. And here I am, 6 years into this, and just finding out about Alzheimer's Society. My mom has now just hit stage 4, needs to go to a nursing home. Where was all this information when she was first diagnosed? Why aren't the doctors saying, here, your family's here for this meeting. Here's some information where you can go get help. There was nothing like that. So I can't avoid anything now. It's too late for our family, but it would be really nice to see that the doctors hand out stuff.
That's what happened to us. When we had our memory test, the doctor, she was a very good doctor. We liked her a lot. But she didn't have any real concern about this challenge. She didn't, she agreed to do the testing, no problem, but it was all very casual and not, you know, she didn't agree with any of the research, and she was not giving us any information for follow-up. She gave us the choice of 3 medications, allowed us to do our own research and choose which one, and that was it.
Medication? My mom's not even on anything.
Right.
So, like, why you and not her? Like,
right.
I don't understand.
Right.
I'm listening to a lot of valuable information here tonight and saying, my God, where has all this information been hiding? You know?
Thank you. Can I respond?
Please.
So, it is really hard to actually do a definite diagnosis of dementia. Generally, someone actually has to have an autopsy done to determine, and we usually don't want to have pieces of our brain taken out while we're still alive. So what they do is they look at the symptomology and try to determine then what is the probable, you know, cause of behaviors or symptoms that are occurring. And Dr. Michael Borey is a fantastic geriatrician at the Aging Brain and Memory Clinic. And one of the studies that he spoke about was the surprising number of misdiagnoses that happened, because it was just, you know, someone who has frontal temporal dementia behaviors, and it turns out they actually had Alzheimer's disease, but it was atypical. So it's really hard. They can never really do a 110% definitive diagnosis until the time of death, really. But they will, a good physician will try and rule out all the other things that could be causing symptoms, because sometimes there could be a chemical imbalance in the body that ends up causing some, you know, behaviors. Delirium. People get delirium and suddenly they have poor short-term memory, they're confused, lethargic, and they start to have certain behaviors. That's treatable. and the person clears up. Or even mental health. If someone has depression, you know, they might get forgetful. Treat the depression, and the symptom of short-term memory loss largely goes away. So, you know, or substance use.
I was just going to say, people that have struggled a lot with addictions and drink a lot of alcohol, we find out more that that can even cause symptoms of cognitive impairment and falls and even hallucinations and all types of different symptoms that are easily misdiagnosed as dementia. But if they were to stop drinking some of the alcohol, some of those symptoms can be prevented and decreased. So you're right, it's a really good point that a thorough assessment needs to be completed.
Where, and this person had toxicity, poisoning. She was good for palliative care, almost dying, hallucinating, everything. And the problem, what it was, the doctors put her on too much medication, didn't check out the other medication she was on, and so she was very hallucinative. She didn't know where she was, what she was doing, couldn't eat, just let me die. And I went, what are you doing? Like, lady, why don't you want to live? Mm-hmm. You have a husband that loves you to death. Your family's here. Like, you know, and I tried to give her some advice and talk to her. The next day, her husband came up and said, thank you so much, because you know what? We looked into this a little bit deeper, and this is what the doctor said, but trust me. And did you trust her? Yes, we did. And I said, good for you. So because somebody puts your loved one on a different medication, always be sure that they've looked at the rest, that it's compatible, because it can do a lot of harm. Mm-hmm. Can do a lot of harm.
Yeah.
But and good for the doctors, you know, yeah. Because if they weren't there, where would we be today? So.
Well, I was just going to say about the physicians, they are learning,
yes.
And they are, you know, we are seeing more physicians with an increased interest in understanding cognitive impairment, and you know, the family health teams have their memory screening clinics. And in that model, we're lucky in the Southwest Lynn, so in Southwestern Ontario, they follow something called the memory, the Dr. Linda Lee memory clinic model. And it's a great interdisciplinary team. And they even include someone from the Alzheimer's Society on that team who talks to the family, who talks to the person who may have a diagnosis of possible dementia and gives them information and you know, and basically opens the door to them. So it's happening, it's starting, but and so, and you know what, and if you look at, we try to use technology, you know, through the camera, through websites, through Twitters, you know, tweets, sorry, I joined Twitter, I still don't know how to talk about it. So send the odd tweet on Twitter. But you know what, the services are there, and you know, we try our best, same thing with Behavioral Supports Ontario, and we are, all of us are really trying to educate physicians as well.
So this will be our last question. We will stick around, we have some time afterwards for you to speak to the panelists and to mingle, just to try to stick to our schedule as much as possible.
I just wanted to add, I'm so glad you raised the point about the doctor not giving information or advice at the time of diagnosis, and I certainly support everything that's been said. You know, doctors are very busy people, it's a complex process to diagnose someone, and you can't know everything. But I guess the mess, and we work very hard at the society and all the other agencies involved here tonight to try to get that public education message out there to get people to know about our services. I guess what I would ask is that when you've had an experience like that with a healthcare professional or a physician, to gently say to them, you know, it would have been really great if you could have told me about some of these things, you know, 3 years ago or 5 years ago or whatever. Here's a leaflet, maybe, you know, educate yourself or they'll come and speak to you, or, you know, help us out to get the information out there, because it is so important, and we know that it makes a big difference if people get the information at an earlier stage.
Thank you very much. So, just going to grab my notes here so I don't make a slip up. So we do still have a bit of time to enjoy this lovely room. And I did want to say thank you to our panelists for sharing their wisdom and insights. And Also, I wanted to thank all of you for coming, and just a reminder that we do have the information at the back of the room. I really encourage you to speak to the different agencies, a great opportunity to get that information about what services are available. And we have given you a survey on the chair, so if you don't see the survey, please look at another chair, probably one there. And this feedback is really, really valuable for us for planning for future events. And again, thank you all for coming out tonight. Thank you for those who are listening and watching online. And again, thank you. It was a great collaboration to work with our partners again this year. And also thank you again to the City of London for hosting us tonight. So with that, thank you very much.